Learning languages can be hard. That is whatever the language, but some things make it harder, and one of these is culture. In 2012, in contrast to only 46% of the EU as a whole, 61% of people in the UK were completely monolingual. That's the same percentage as were quadrilingual in Luxembourg. In the UK and many other English-speaking countries, there's definitely a sense of, well, we speak the world language, so we don't need to learn anyone else's. Which partially makes sense. I mean, English is the main language of intercontinental trade, and if you already know that language, that is one reason for learning gone. But it's also true that this is part of an English linguistic chauvinism. I mean, everyone in the world doesn't speak English, do they? But there's still this sense you find among a lot of English speakers that everyone should. So yes, there are underlying cultural and social reasons for this disparity between the UK and other European nations. But 91% of Swedes and 89% of Danes didn't learn to speak at least two languages conversationally by believing more in the importance of foreign languages. And if this was the entire reason, how do you explain the similar rates of monolingualism in Hungary, Italy, and Portugal? Last time I checked, Hungarian wasn't the language of international commerce. There are concrete and systematic differences to be considered here, so let's see, why are the English so bad at languages? Now, when I say English people, I do not mean to generalize. Let's not forget that native English speakers can learn other languages. In fact, monolingualism can be cured in anyone. And that's why this video is sponsored by italki. Italki is, I wouldn't say just a language app, it's a whole set of language learning resources. It's a marketplace where teachers and learners can meet and communicate for a personalized language learning experience. You have one-on-one customized language lessons with high-quality native speaking teachers, allowing you to fit learning into your busy life while keeping the access to resources and real human connection that you get from a proper tutor. A teacher helps you stay motivated, know what to learn next, and consider your long-term goals, which are all major factors in keeping your learning going. There are tutors all over the world teaching more than 150 languages at all times of day, so whether it's French, Spanish, or standard Mandarin which catches your fancy, you can find someone for you on italki. Best of all, you pay per lesson on italki, no subscription, no commitments, and lessons start at only $5. I myself went and tried an Indonesian lesson with Teddy.
And from tahun, we can say ulang tahun, birthday. Repeat year, birthday. And if you put selamat in front, it becomes happy birthday.
And I learned a lot, so thanks to Teddy and to italki for making this meeting possible. And if you use my code, you can get $5 off your first $10 purchase. It's only available for the first 50 users, so get on that right away, say hi to Teddy from me, and thank you to italki for sponsoring this video. The most learned language in Sweden is English, to great success, with over 90% of the population claiming proficiency. Things look very similar in Denmark, with 86% of the population saying they can speak English. How does a non-native population become so good at another language? Well, there are a few variables to be considered. The first is exposure, how much people hear a language, and in Sweden, the English language and languages other than Swedish in general are everywhere, which means lots of exposure, which means an easier time learning the target language. I carried out a preliminary study on the prevalence of foreign languages in media by just noting down what languages were prominently featured in a week's television. For Sweden, I used SVT 1 and SVT 2, and for England, I used the equivalent BBC 1 and BBC 2. This is the pie chart for Swedish TV. As you see, less than 3/4 of programs are actually in Swedish, with English, Danish, and Finnish all being consistently represented throughout the week. If we take out all the national languages of Sweden, we're left with this, and we see that English represents a majority of foreign TV, but that we also have significant representation of Danish, Norwegian, and French. The other here includes Spanish, Icelandic, German, and other languages. Now, here's the pie chart for BBC England. And when I say pie chart, I mean more of a pie, an unsliced uniform orange pie. There was not a single foreign language program or film showed on BBC One or Two that week. Of course, this study is not all that great. It was done by one person quickly to prove a point, and this is just two channels in just one week, and a larger study would be much better. People watch way more streaming services than TV nowadays anyway, but that being said, I think it does quite nicely demonstrate the phenomenon I'm talking about. There's a definite difference in attitude and in practice when it comes to language exposure. This is pretty difficult to change on a societal level. I mean, what policies could you even introduce? A mandatory minimum percentage of foreign TV? Maybe? But you wouldn't want that to come at the expense of the local TV industry. I just don't think it's a very practical policy. However, it is a good thing to keep in mind as an individual language learner. Watch films, listen to music, that's the way you're really going to grasp your target language. But exposure in media isn't the only difference between England and Scandinavia. In fact, I'd say another factor has an even bigger impact. Schooling. In Sweden, children typically start learning English at around 7 to 9 years old, with consistent lessons generally up until when they finish school. Although foreign languages are technically required at primary school in England, the implementation of this has proven to be difficult with poorly designed curricula, and a little secret from inside the industry, a lot of those primary school language teachers do not speak the language they're teaching. They take a one-day course based around how to teach any language. So we need... Well, we need better salaries for primary school teachers to make it economically viable for university-educated individuals to take these job positions. A proper national curriculum for primary school languages would be useful. Starting when children are young is one of the most important components to ending monolingualism. We also have to consider the other end of that, I mean when pupils are older. Getting them to continue their language education into the advanced level as they do in Sweden with English. So let's take a look at GCSEs. GCSEs are an exam-based qualification most pupils in England, Wales, and Northern Ireland take at age 15 or 16, at the end of year 11. This is a graph of entries, across all three countries, bear in mind, not just England, for second language education, and as you see, taking these GCSEs has decreased massively over the last decade, though we might be having a little revival right now. It's hard to tell with so few data points. Taking out the line for all second languages, we can see more clearly what's going on here. French and German education has plummeted, whilst the other section goes up and down. Spanish and Welsh have dramatically increased, and Irish has remained a steady little line at the bottom of the chart. The government has introduced the English baccalaureate qualification to encourage pupils to take a language as one of their GCSE subjects, but this has hardly helped, if at all. If we want to make those numbers go up, then I have a solution for you. Pretty simple, but very controversial. Make languages at GCSE part of the core curriculum again. They used to be, just make them like maths and English. Yep, that whole video just to come to the conclusion, make people learn languages. I mean, we come up with all these complicated excuses about exposure and culture and usefulness, but at the end of the day, we have an education system, where people go to school. If we want people to learn languages, why would we need to look any further? Sometimes it really is that simple. Oh, and you'd have to train teachers more, and pay them more if they're non-native in order to make the training and education worth their time. Learning languages is hard for them too, or if they're native speakers to encourage the educated workforces of other countries to immigrate to the UK. We should consider why we need to learn languages. I mean, it would take a whole video to answer that question, maybe even my next video. And then there's the question of, what languages should we be learning? Why are some of the biggest languages of the world not on this chart? Like, Mandarin Chinese, Indonesian, Hindi, Swahili? What about the biggest minority languages in the UK, like Polish or Punjabi? Okay, maybe it isn't that simple. Maybe we have a lot of factors going into our decisions here and a lot of decisions to make. Maybe education and language were political all along. No, just kidding, don't worry. I wouldn't want to bring politics into everything now. That sounds very boring.